Okay, well, thanks all for coming for the talk on building the Drupal 8 front end with AngularJS. So I'm John Ennew, lead developer at Deeson Group. We're a development agency based down in Canterbury. We've got a distributed team as well, and we're hiring at the moment as well. So if anyone wants to talk to me about that afterwards, then please come and see me. And our favourite colour is red. So it's got an idea of the audience in the room. Who in the room considers themselves a front-end developer? And who, out of your front-end developers, who's worked with AngularJS already? Has anyone got any AngularJS in production at the moment? Anyone got AngularJS in production with Drupal at the moment? Okay. So this is kind of an introduction to this subject. So if anyone, I won't be offended if you want to leave now. But the idea of this talk is I'm going to talk about building a decoupled application, what it means to build a decoupled application. We'll also be looking at the other model, which is the progressive decoupling, and I've got some an example site that I'll be demonstrating as well, so you can see what an application in AngularJS and Drupal looks like in the real world. And then I'll be looking at the steps you need to do in order to build yourself, to set up your tool chain for building, working with AngularJS, working with Drupal, and just to give you an overview of the kind of things that you'll start doing if you want to go down this route to build a decoupled application. So just a little overview. Deeson's looked at, went out looking for a front-end framework about 18 months, 2 years ago. And at the time, we selected AngularJS. This is Angular 1 to fulfill needs. We thought that was the one that was mostly closely to what we wanted to do. And the reason we went out there looking for a separate front-end framework rather than using Drupal's theming layer was that we were getting a lot of requests from our clients and the need to do bigger applications, so sort of application design, and they need to do more things than was possible, what we thought were possible with the Drupal theming layer at the time. So I'll kind of take you through that journey as well. So just as an overview for people who are new to this, the traditional model of a Drupal website, the user sits on their web browser, they make a request to the server, Drupal then interprets that request, goes away, pulls all the data it needs in order to serve the request, then passes the data down to the Drupal theming layer, and the Drupal theming layer then builds the HTML and returns it to the browser. So the application is being built on the server and not in the browser, and Drupal is doing the theming for that. So Drupal is providing us with both a content management system. I mean, Drupal is many things, but in this scenario, we're thinking of Drupal as a content management system. So it's the place where the administrators are going to build their and construct their content. But it's also a website delivery tool. So that's the second purpose that it's providing, is it's giving us the HTML to deliver the website. And what we're looking at with Drupal 8 in particular, or the other models, is rather than providing the website, Drupal is going to provide us with the data. So the administrators still are entering their content into the system, but what comes out of Drupal isn't rendered HTML. We're going to take data out, and then we're going to use a different framework, the front-end framework, in order to turn that into a website. And this isn't the only model. So in the example I'll show you in a moment, we've got the ability for the administrators to use Drupal and the Drupal 8 backend in order to fill Drupal with content and use Drupal as a content management system. But then we can, if we don't want to build our own API to that data, we can use things like the Search API module to take the data out of Drupal and to index it into some other system that perhaps already provides us with an API. So for example, something like Solr or Elasticsearch is a particularly good example as well. So the end users aren't interfacing with Drupal at all. What they're actually doing is communicating with perhaps an Elasticsearch API. The data is actually sat in another system, is indexed in another system, but is managed by Drupal. So what is Angular? What is AngularJS? So AngularJS is a front-end framework, so it's going to be doing all of that theming layer that we do inside of Drupal, but instead of that, we're going to be doing it in JavaScript, and it's going to be rendered in the browser. So AngularJS has a templating language and templating engine, and it uses HTML to build its templates. And later on in the talk, I'll do a demonstration exactly how you go about constructing those templates, so you can understand what that looks like compared to doing this with Drupal. And why did we select AngularJS? When we were looking at the marketplace and what was out there for front-end frameworks, one of the main points of Angular when we were looking at it some 18 months ago was that it has a very large community and it's backed by Google as well. So Google is doing a lot of the development work for it. But there's also a huge community of people out there using AngularJS. And the important thing about that is that when you have any problems or you find a solution, you think, well, there must be somebody out there that's already solved this particular problem, and that information is already available on Stack Exchange, or people have blogged about it, or ngmodules.org is a place where you can download modules for AngularJS. So you think, well, this must be a solved problem, you'll find modules for those problems on ngmodules.org. So it's got a big ecosystem, just like Drupal has. And of course, it's a front-end framework as well. So it's providing, it's got a very rich vocabulary of things under the hood, which are going to be doing things for us. So anyone familiar with Drupal 8 and Symfony framework as well will recognize a lot of the terminology that's on this board, on this screen, which shows us what AngularJS is providing us with. So it's got the idea of controllers and directives and services. And these are all things we would expect, not just from a front-end framework, but from any good software framework. So this allows us to build a good, well-structured application rather than perhaps what we were doing previously with JavaScript, which was kind of building scripts and kind of tying them together. We can now build a fully featured application at the front end. And that, of course, allows us to test the code we're doing well and to build a good, well-structured application. So in the purely headless model, we take away all of the theme processing from Drupal and we give it all to AngularJS. So Drupal's just providing either a data feed, either directly or through some form of search API, like Elasticsearch. In a progressive model, Drupal still does some of the theme processing. So we go to Drupal first for our web page, and perhaps Drupal then provides us with the framework of the page. So it's going to give us the index.html, it's going to provide us with the header, the footer of the page, and then a region in the centre which is going to embed our AngularJS application inside it. And then that application will then go off and get the information, perhaps from another source or perhaps from Drupal itself. And the advantage of the progressive model over the purely headless model is that There's an awful lot of stuff that Drupal gives you out of the box that you still want to make use of, things like URL routing, things like the menu system. And we'll have a look a bit later on exactly what that means when we see an actual application and how we would build it. So I'm just going to switch over to the browser and see if I can show you an example application. This is one of the first applications we built for one of our clients, and the reason we selected AngularJS is the front-end framework. So this is an interface for searching an art collection of some, it's about 250,000 objects in it, 100,000 of which have got images. So this is the live site at the moment. And what we found with, if we were going to build this just purely with Drupal form API, is that there might be some limitations in the way that we can construct the form. So it's not very clear on this screen, but there is form elements on here, and this allows us to build up a search for the data within this collection. And then underneath we have our search results coming through, and these are building underneath the actual search interface. And some of the nice things you can do if you're now rendering this in the browser rather than in Drupal is if you do things like want to change the view mode, we don't have to have a full screen refresh. So here we've got a tiled view, or we can switch to the record view like this. And it just happens in the browser and there's nothing else needs to, there's no screen refresh, and the page just renders it much nicer. So if we then did a search, so if we're going to look for things that Queen Victoria, Purchase is a prolific collector of art, and we can just apply that search term there, and already the search, the items that are related to Queen Victoria in some way are brought back. And if we want to apply a second search into that, so let's see the objects that she's created, and then the page results just refresh underneath. So what we're doing here is within the AngularJS application, we're constructing a search object, so we're constructing a piece of state on the client side inside of the browser. Which are the information about the search, and then that is then sent via AJAX requests back to the search service, and then it's sending us the data directly. So we're not actually talking to Drupal directly; we're talking to a search service, but the content administrators are entering their data through Drupal, and this allows us to then make quite a rich search experience. So we can then start building up additional facets. So if we want things that are linked to both Queen Victoria and Prince Albert, then we can add additional facets there as well, and we can get quite a rich search experience. And we're also able to do things like apply secondary filters inside there as well. So whereas Queen Victoria was the creator, Prince Albert was the subject, and then we should be able to find things that drawings of Prince Albert by Queen Victoria. And this just goes on, so we can then keep constructing additional facets to our search interface. So perhaps we want to restrict that by a particular category, whether it's from the arms and armor category, or we only want to find things that are at a particular location. It allows us to construct quite a complex search query. So that was just a demonstration of what's possible when you start using a front-end framework to build your application out. I'm now going to go through the process of getting started with AngularJS and what you'll need to do to build your first AngularJS application. But before you begin, if you've not worked with front-end frameworks before or any of the new front-end technologies, there's an awful lot of subsidiary build chain things that you'll need to get up to date with and to understand what they are in order to start using these tools. So one of the first things you want to install on your development environment will be Node and NPM. So Node is it's a server-side technology for executing JavaScript, and what it's used for within a development of a front-end application is as the server on the application, so it's going to serve up your initial application for you. NPM is the package manager for Node. So the first thing you want to do is install Node, and there's some instructions there on how to do it for Mac and Linux. And then just check it's running with Node-V. The second tool you'll need is a JavaScript package manager, and this is a bit like Composer for PHP. Bower is a good choice for this. So again, install Bower globally with npm install -g Bower. So now you've got npm and Bower installed. Next tools you'll need are a task runner. What a task runner does is it allows you to bundle up a series of instructions together and call that a task, and that can then be installed with your front-end application, so that the next developer who comes to work on your front-end application that you're building needs only have a look inside the grunt file, if you're using grunt, to see what the build steps are to build your application. So an example task might be a test task, and there might be a number of steps that need to happen in order to test your application. So if you're building that application, you can define those inside of the grunt as a grunt task, and then the next developer that comes along need only look inside the grunt file, see that there's a test task, and they can just double click that to run the test. And we'll look at that in a little bit more detail in a moment. Next tool we probably want is a scaffolding tool. Yeoman's a good choice. There's other scaffolding tools, such as Slush out there, but Yeoman's what we use. And what a scaffolding tool does is it allows you to provide a recipe to start and to scaffold your application. So if you're starting with nothing, you use Yeoman to say, right, I'd like to build an Angular application, please, and it will go away and construct the folders and the files and pull in all the necessary dependencies to get started on building your application. And the next thing to consider, of course, is the testing frameworks. Karma is one that's produced by, supported by Angular, and that's one that people, if you're using AngularJS on its own, you're writing your tests using the Karma language. We use bhat and just run the tests through a headless browser as well. But the important thing is that you keep your tests with your test code with the rest of your application's code. Okay, so now I'm just going to go through the steps of building a Drupal 8 backend and a front-end application with AngularJS. So in Drupal 8, for this example, a simple example, we'll be using the Views module and the RESTful Web Services module to provide us with those JSON endpoints as data API endpoints, and then we'll consume that within an Angular application. So switch over to here. Okay, so this is my Drupal 8 website, and what we're going to produce is a blogging platform. So if I have a look inside of the structure, you can see under the content types that we've got a blog post content type, And if I manage the fields on there, you see it's quite a simple content type. It's got a title, and then it's got just one field, which is the body field. And so in order to provide that information via a data API, what we're going to do is create a view using the use REST service module. So I've constructed a view called blog. And if we edit that and have a look. So this is going to be a view which is at slash blog. This is a view of type REST. So if I just hit this out one here, you see there's a display type provided by the RESTful Web Services module, which is the REST export. So that's the type of this view. We're then displaying the fields. So these are the fields we want inside it. Title, UID, which uniquely identifies each piece of content on the system. Then a field for the body, the path, and the content type as well. So that's the machine name for the content type. And we'll see what that's used for later. So if I now go to slash blog, we can see that we're getting JSON back. So this is the title, the UID, the HTML for the body, the path and the type of the post. So there we have, we've got our Drupal website acting as a content management system and now providing information back via a REST API. Okay, so now you're ready to start your front-end application. So we talked about using Yeoman for scaffolding the app. So before we've started anything else, then these three commands, we can make a directory for our project called Angular Drupal 8, go inside the directory and then use Yeoman, Yo Angular, Angular Drupal 8, says I want to create a new front-end project called of type Angular. So Angular is the recipe and the project's going to be called Angular Drupal 8. Once we've run those three commands, then what we get is a project directory which looks like this. And I'll just go through the elements of that. So inside of here we've got an app directory, which is where our source code is going to go. There's directories there for barrel components and node modules, so these are our external dependencies that are going to be pulled in, and we'll look at those in a moment in a bit more detail. And then there's a directory in there as well for our test code, for any tests that we write on the system. At the bottom down here, we've got a file called the grumpfile.js. And this was produced to us by the Yeoman script, and it's already got within it a series of tasks that will allow us to run and build our application for us automatically. And because I'm using PHP Storm is grunt-aware, and I get a link in my, because that grumpfile is there, I get a link down in my PHP Storm window, which tells you what tasks are available to me. And those tasks are the build task, which is what we'll run once we're ready to deploy the application. And this was what turns all of the code within our app directory, and it compiles it down into something we can actually place on the server ready for distribution. There's a test task in there, which is going to execute all the tests. And there's a serve task here, which we're going to use now for actually running the application in development. So by double-clicking on this, it kicks off a series of steps which then fires up the Angular application. So without having to do very much, we're already at a point where we can start development. We've got everything in place to allow us to do it. So if we just look at the anatomy of an Angular app now. So inside of that app directory, we get several files, one of which is the index.html. So if this is a headless application, this is the single file of the single file application. So this is the first file that gets requested by the browser, is the index.html. Inside here, there's a few things we just want to look at. There's a tag here, the ng-app directive, which is applied to the body tag. And this tells us the scope of our project, so the project that we're going to be building. So in a moment, we'll look at the actual Angular JavaScript, and it's going to work on this body tag or on the code within it. Down inside here, we've got a hard-coded menu. So the application's got three menu entries, which are the home, the about, and the blog links, which you can see under the menu, home, about, and blog. So those have been hard-coded into this headless application. And then down here, one other thing to look at is this div here, which has got the ng-view directive applied to it. And what ngview directive is going to do is a bit later on when the Angular application runs, is going to look inside our HTML, looking for the point at which to place the HTML that gets rendered by the Angular application. This is where it's going to go inside. At the bottom of the file, we've got our included dependencies. So these are scripts that are required for running the application. And underneath are our scripts that we're going to write ourselves. So these are the components of the our custom code. And each of those are contained inside these comments. And what these comments are telling the build script. So when we come to actually deploy our application, all of those files get concatenated down into a single file. So all of these get concatenated down into a vendor.js. And these underneath them get minified into a scripts.js file. So in the scripts directory, we've got an app.js, which is the first one that gets executed. And this is where the application actually gets bootstrapped. So in here, we are defining our application we're building. So we've called it Angular Drupal 8 app. So this is the name of our application. And underneath, we've specified the modules we're going to be using. So these are the Angular modules. Most of these are ones that got created for us by the Yeoman script. If we wanted to include our own modules later on, so if you found a module you wanted to use from ngmodules.com, you'd also specify it in here as well to say that your application depended on it. And then underneath, during the bootstrapping process as well, we've got a configuration section. And inside here, we're passing in two parameters. And this is Angular's way of doing dependency injection. So there's two services, and we're saying that we depend on them at this point. One service is the root provider service, and the other one is the location provider service. And underneath there, we then configure these two services. So with the root provider service, we're going to tell it what the routes are for our application. So there's forward slash, which is the home page. And if the application is on at the forward slash, and it's going to use the main controller, which we'll look at what that means in a moment, and it's going to supply a template in the views directory under main, main.html. So what we'll look at next, I think, is so the blog page. So if we go to, you can't quite see that here. So we've gone to slash blog, so that's the root. So if you have a look at slash blog under here, you can see that that's what the root is going to be defined as. It's going to make use of the blog controller, and it's going to use this template to render the results. So if we now look at that blog controller and see where that comes from. So underneath controllers, I've got a blog.js file. And up here, we've specified a, in our Angular application, we've specified the that there is a blog controller. And so inside of here, the blog controller relies on two services, one of which is called $scope. And this is the global scope, and this is the place where we're going to put data, so that data is then available to other controllers and also to our view, which we'll have a look in a moment. And the HTTP service. And the HTTP service is what we use to dial out and request data from external services. So underneath, see, we've created an array on the global scope. We're requesting data from our Drupal 8 development site at slash blog, and then we use the HTTP service to go away to that path, and then we get some data back, which of course is our JSON feed we saw earlier. And we're going to place that on the global scope under the blogs variable. Going back to app.js, that was the blog controller, then went away and got the blog's information from Drupal. It then needs to render that into its template, and the template we're using is the views listing blog.html. So underneath the views directory here, underneath listing, we have a blog.html file. And there's not a lot much going on here, but this is the this is Angular's templating engine. So we've got our own template here, and the templating engine is HTML. We can see we're looping over each blog in blogs. Blogs is obviously the thing we just populated on the global scope. And for each blog, we print out a H2, which is its title, and a link underneath, which is a read more link, which takes us to blog slash and then the UUID. So there's the blog, there's the titles, and then we have a link going to each one. So we'll just quickly go through this one now. So when I clicked on that link, it took me to blog slash and then the UUID, and then we've got the actual data coming back for that specific blog post. So just running through the steps again, we can quickly see that under app.js, we've got a blog slash UUID. That colon indicates that there's going to be a variable being passed in, which is the actual specific UUID. We've got a blog post controller this time. So again, inside of our blog.js file, we've got a second controller called the blog post controller. This one relies on the scope and the HTTP services as well, but it also relies on the root param service being passed in. And the root param service is what tells us what's being passed into the root, the parameter that got passed into the root, which is the UID. And this time we request from Drupal the blog slash and the UID, and we'll get the specific blog post back again. That then gets placed on the global scope in the blog variable. And then going back to our router, we can see that the template URL is under pages and blog.html. And inside here, we've just got a very basic template, which is going to print out the title and the body of that blog post. So that's kind of a really high overview of all of the things that you start to put together when you start building a front-end application. It shows you where the templates live, where the application logic lives within your front-end application, and how those things can tie together and how you go away and get that information, the data that you need back from a Drupal backend. So there's an awful lot more that we need to consider in here. I've hard-coded the menu. This is a headless application, so it's been completely run, completely delivered via AngularJS, and we're only using Drupal as the data store. So if you want to build something that's completely headless like this, then you've stepped away from a lot of the good things that Drupal gives you out of the box. For example, the ability to manage your own menu. If you want to give your content editors the ability to manage the menu, you're now going to have to build an endpoint which tells the Drupal application where to find that menu. So your Angular application is going to make perhaps several callbacks to get the menu, to get the content of the page, to get anything else from the page. And one of the other things perhaps you'd be walking away from as well is the ability to specify your URLs. So here we've kind of got a very ugly URL just in order to return the blog post. But just as an example, just to show you some of these things are overcomable, you just have to build these things in yourself. I've got here a page that's coming back, so slash about is a page that slash about URL is an alias that we've told Drupal about. The Angular application has no idea what is at slash about, so we have a quickly look at it in the app.js file. We look at the routing again. None of the routes in here tell us about slash about. It's just the homepage, the blog, and the specific blog post. But there's a separate section at the bottom called otherwise. So if none of the routes match, I've written a controller which is going to go and ask Drupal what's at the URL that's been given. So quickly look at that. So inside of content, here's my content controller. And this does something. This is very basic. What it does is we've got an endpoint to Drupal called slash content where we pass in the path. So the location controller gives us the current route, and then we'll go back to Drupal and ask what's at that path. And Drupal will either tell us or it will respond with a not found, and we'll just set the not found template. So, well, you might as well now, go on. So for the headless application, there's no templating system going on here. The art client website I showed you earlier, that one, there is an amount of Drupal templating going on. So Drupal is providing us with the header and footer of the page, but the search interface in the middle and the results of that page, that's an Angular application providing that. So Drupal is giving us the basic page, and then everything in between is being given to us by the Angular application. You end up doing theming in two places. So you'll do some theming inside of Drupal 8 to provide you with the basic template of the page. And then in Angular, Angular is completely separate in a way. So then you would then do whatever templating you needed to do within Angular. So you've separated up into two projects this way. So I was just going to quickly show you this one. So I've built a controller which allows us to get the data back there. So if we just have a quick look at what that looks like on the Drupal. So there's a Drupal view which at slash content which takes an argument of the path and it goes and gives us the path back, whereas if we chose a thing that didn't exist, we get nothing back from Drupal this time. And so in the app.js we can see that once we've done the logic to get the data about what's at that path, then we use the view slash content HTML to render the page. And inside of here we've got what's effectively a switch statement, and it's telling us we're going to load in either a 404 not found page, or we're going to load in the right page for the content that's come back again. So this is just an example of what you might have to do if you're going to build a completely headless application. You're going to have to do some things that Drupal isn't providing you with. Okay, I'll just quickly go through the last few slides. As mentioned before, there's plenty of modules available on ngmodules.org. So if you get to a point where you now need to add perhaps an infinite scroll to one of your pages and you realise that this must be something that somebody else has solved at some point, go to ngmodules.org, have a search around, and perhaps you'll find this module looks like it does the work you want to do. In which case, there's instructions there for installing it using Bower, and you can add it to your application. If your headless application is on a different domain from your Drupal site, then you're going to have to use something called core support, where you tell this cross-origin request source. So this is something where you tell your headless app, you define from your Drupal site what other websites are allowed to access the content or to use the content. So I don't think there's anything within Drupal 8 at the moment that allows you to do this. Well, there are some patches and people talking about it at the moment, but you can use your rules within Nginx or Apache to always supply this particular header, which is the access control allow origin header, and afterwards you specify which domains the data from the Drupal site is allowed to be used on. So the top one says I only want it to be used on the localhost domain, whereas the one underneath with the star and it says actually the data coming from my Drupal site can be used on any domain. Yes, what's the catch? So we mentioned a few of the catches before, the fact that you're stepping away from Drupal. So you're going to have to kind of hand build a lot of the things that Drupal is providing you without the box. For example, some things like login, the ability to log into your site. You're going to have to build some instruction to allow you to do that. Things like the menu and the routing, those are all things that you'll need to now build, consider yourself. Another big one is SEO. So if you've got a headless application, then I think some of the crawlers will try and execute your JavaScript. But if you want to ensure that all of the content on your site is indexable, then Google suggestions at the moment are that you provide a non JavaScript way of getting to your content. And there's a couple of ways of doing that. So one is that you can just create your HTML alternatives on the site, and there's things you can put into the meta tags at the top of the page. This URL here, which you can't quite see, but it gives you information from Google where it tells you what it is you need to do. So you have your JavaScript app URL, which most people use, and then you have kind of ugly URLs, which the search engines and the search crawlers will use to get the data from the site. Rather than having to create two versions of your website, you can use, there's some instructions at this site here, you can use frontend.js to crawl your site for you and produce those HTML pages automatically. There are also paid for services that allow you to do this as well. And that's everything. So yeah, thanks very much for your time. For any questions.
You have the Drupal page and then the Angular app sitting inside where you said the header and footer is. How have you included that? Is that just an iframe, or have you got some other solution to include the Angular app back inside where the main template is?
Do you want to record?
Yeah, so the question was, how do you include your Angular app inside of a Drupal rendered page? In the example given, just close that one down. So we've got, so this isn't an iframe, it's an application that's built, it's included in the page. So we would include those in the same way as you include any JavaScript within a Drupal application. So we include the JavaScript files, and then you tag the element of the page that you want the Angular application to work on. And it works on that element. So it is just JavaScript at the end of the day, so you just include the right JavaScript files at the right point, and it will execute on the page. So your Angular app starts at that index.html, which is what we showed you. But this is this could have any HTML within it. This isn't actually part of the app. The Angular app starts at the JavaScript, and you just put some tags inside your HTML to say where you want it to start start working on. So inside of here, we're starting here. But this page, this index.html page, could have been rendered by Drupal, and then which is how you then embed it in the progressive way. Okay. So the question is, what can you do if JavaScript's not available? I think for us, and the way that we've used it, we're selective about the ways we're in. So we haven't built an entire site out of an AngularJS application. We look for those places where it was particularly useful at this point. We are now thinking about what it is we would do in terms of a complete website and whether you'd have a fallback. Google's suggestion is that you do have a fallback because that's the thing that the search engines want to use. In terms of the demonstration site that I showed you, it is just the search interface. There is a very simple search interface that, if you haven't got that enabled, you just go to one where you can just you've just got your standard sort of Drupal form where you can type in some text and press enter, and the server will do the search for you. But you lose all the richness of the application as a result of that. So the ability to build that rich application becomes much harder if you're only doing it through the Drupal website.
So when Angular kicks in and targets the directives you've given markup, is it replacing stuff that was there, which is the fallback? So it's stripping that out before it then injects what it's doing?
Yes, although you wouldn't be able to get to that page without JavaScript enabled. So you'll just be left with the site search in that situation, which is just your basic search. Okay, so the question is, do we load in all of the information about the 90,000 art objects on that particular site and then do all the searching locally, or do we construct the search and then, what we actually do is we construct the search locally and then we send the constructed search as a request out to the search API, and the search API then returns the first page of results. And so every time you manipulate the search through the search interface, the object, which is held in state in the browser, is changed. And once that changes, it triggers a request back to the server to say, and this is what the search looks like now, and then you get the first page of results back in the page. That search results bit then rebuilds itself underneath. We're not holding several hundred thousand pieces of data on the site because that would take a long time to pull all that in.
I suppose the big selling point for this sort of separated structure is that there are a few things I've heard about, that it's quick to develop in, that it's safe to deploy onto if you keep everything separate, and it's faster as well. Are those things you'd agree with? Are there other reasons why you ought to build in an Angular API framework?
Okay, so the question is what are the other advantages to and you give some examples there of speed and ease of development. One of the other good reasons for taking Angular, which I didn't touch on, which I probably should have done, which was around how you construct your development team around it as well. Finding good Drupal developers in the theming, that are good at the theming layer, becomes quite hard because you get quite a narrow set of skills that are required there. By separating this out, you open yourself up to all of the people that are working in the front-end JavaScript space who don't know any Drupal, but do know how to build like good quality user interfaces and web applications, of which I think there are more people out there, and allowing them to do that. So it improves your ability to bring in talent into the development pool. It also frees those front-end developers from Drupal, and there are a lot of people that would prefer, front-end developers who prefer not to work with Drupal. There's a number of those people out there as well. And so you can have your Drupal specialists and you can have your front-end specialists, and you get the best of both worlds. Of course, that brings some dangers as well, because you're obviously separating your development team out. I know some places perhaps then create kind of a front-end group and a back-end group, and they only talk to each other over an API document, which is definitely not the right way to run your projects. Very much be in favour of making sure that those people are still collaborating very closely and they're working together to do this thing. And actually, I see a lot of back-end developers that are very interested in AngularJS as well, because it's bringing form and structure to what was the front-end sphere. And actually, the back-end development doesn't stop at the API. It goes into the Angular application, and actually, all we're doing is the front-end developers are now working on the views, kind of the templating side of the Angular application, and the back-end developers are working perhaps on the program logic at this level. So they're working on both the API and the consuming of that API on the client side. We haven't got any specific standard. I mean, obviously, there are the REST standards and the way that you should structure them. For a Drupal 7 builds, we use the RESTful module, and there is a Drupal 8 version of that coming out now, which is a very programmatic way of constructing your API, and it gives you an awful lot of nice things, such as versioning of your API as well, so you have APIs in different versions. I think there's some other talks on APIs and API versioning at Drupalcamp this week as well. But yeah, there's a whole subject on how to deal with the API and how to build your API as well.
Do you have any experience with Angular 2?
So the question is, do I have any experience with Angular 2? We did this process about 18 months ago to decide and made the decision to go with Angular 1. Because it felt like a good fit then. 18 months later, everything's changed, and now we're having to reevaluate everything again. Dries actually put a blog post very recently where his team sort of evaluated all the front-end web frameworks with their thoughts about which one of those perhaps should be brought into Drupal core and perhaps should be standardized, and that's an ongoing debate at the moment. They're finding that they were kind of leaning towards Ember as the front-end framework that might fit well within the Drupal community, but that's an open question at the moment. Angular 2 is really interesting. It is a lot faster. It simplifies a lot of what I've shown you today, actually. It is the number of things that you need to deal with actually reduces down, and Angular 2 ends up looking an awful lot more like React in the way that it's structured and the way that it's working. So, we have to make a decision at some point in the next few months about where we're going to go, because we want to move on to the next new shiny thing. As everyone in the front-end community does. Angular 2 is definitely there, definitely of interest, again, because it's backed by Google, because it's got a very big developer community behind it, but it is still in beta at the moment.
What's the Angular plugin ecosystem like? Is it dependable? Is it flaky?
We found it pretty dependable, as our feelings. I mean, it's the same with, it's the same with Drupal. I mean, you've got to evaluate each module on its individual merits, don't you, and think, that's a good module, seems to do. It seems to do 90% of what I want, and then that last 10% takes me, I could have rewritten it in the time it took me to solve that last 10% of the problem. these things exist, so it's just being on top of what's going on there, reading the blog posts and getting feedback from things like the Angular Connect conference that happens once a year.
But I presume, unlike Drupal, anyone can just throw up a module or plugin, as long as it's got the algorithm and you add the right methods and add it.
Yeah, that is very, very true. I mean, I think the NG modules provides a bit of Yeah, I think it has a bit of structure around that. But yeah, I mean, if you've got a GitHub account, you can just chuck it on there in the same way that, I guess, a PHP Symfony application library, you might be able to just chuck that up on GitHub. But it's whether people are talking about it and whether it's got enough reviews and this that's going on.
So if I understood correctly, your example with search, the front-end app was talking directly to your search infrastructure, not to the Drupal server. And if we imagine that extending a bit, we've got more services, and so your browser's now talking to potentially a number of different bits of infrastructure. Are there, a bit of a vague question, are there any kind of security problems you may have had thinking here potentially, if you're used to working with a closed infrastructure, everyone talks straight to your Drupal server, and your Drupal server knows how to talk to all the other bits, you could be leaking content, or you might even just be giving a DDoS kind of vulnerability.
Yeah, so the question is, if you're publishing all of your content on a search service, which is openly available to the world, are there any security, what considerations do you need to make under that circumstances? It's a very good question, and it very much depends on your application. If you've got lockdown content, you can't put it into a service like that, because the authentication is going to be between an Angular application and a back-end service. So for the example I gave, this is open data, they've just published there. It's good to put it on something like Elasticsearch, because you mentioned the DDoS attack vector that's potentially possible there. If we've opened up a service to the world, perhaps someone can DDoS it. So that's a service you can then put onto the cloud. Somebody else can look after that. So Elasticsearch is a big, well, it's built for this. This is the kind of application that it's there for. So allowing for large quantities of search and access to that kind of data. But yeah, very much comes down to your particular application. You're going to have to hide your data behind some form of custom API or some other service. But this is for high volume. Exactly. If it's high volume, high number of requests, then this kind of setup is really good, and you've taken Drupal out entirely. Yeah. You're just talking to a back-end service which is built for that kind of thing.
So you using Elasticsearch to build that stuff, when you came to configuring all your filters and facets and stuff like that, was that a lot of handwritten code by you, or were you kind of selecting modules? I mean, how much work was involved in that? How much were you using?
I think the question is, how much work is it to index the data?
Yeah, it's like in Drupal, you just grab facet API module and it gives you a bunch of facets.
Yeah, yeah. Well, exactly, and this is what you're stepping away from, I think. So the ease of being able to just configure a few modules and click some buttons, and then you go, okay, well, there's my site, but it looks like a Drupal site, because that's the kind of sites that they do. So if you want to build an interface which allows you to do that, to build up facets, to build up search terms, so we've got the ability to say, okay, here's one type of person, then I'm going to add a second person, and a second person, and I'm going to add some sub-features to that as well. These are all very complex things. It was a long project, and it had a lot of complexity within it. So, yeah, this is a big project, I think. Not for this particular search interface, but I mean, in terms of the back end of that, I mean, where we index the data, these are things that are freely available. The way that your search interface works is that it is just data and facets at the end of the day, so it's just about structuring that in the right way. But yeah. Have we got time for one?
It's quarter to now.
So, okay, I'll be around for a little while, so if anyone wants to talk to me anymore. Okay, thanks very much.